Ham Radio Now, episode 101. We're on the 101. The California episode.
I haven't been on that road in a long time.
I was on it quite a bit over the big trip.
Oh, yeah, just recently.
Yeah, episode 101, A Tale of Two Emcomm Vehicles. It kind of spoils the poetry. add the word vehicles.
Yeah.
But anyway, we have to hurry because you have something to do today.
Yeah.
What are you doing?
It's the NASCAR race in Charlotte. Bobby and I are off to the NASCAR race. I had to wear my racing gear over here.
Racing gear. Is that a racing hat?
Well, it says Smith & Wesson on it, but the stripes, you know, make a racing
stripe.
Hat.
Yeah. Do you have a racing stripe anywhere else I should know about?
Well, including the yellow one up my back.
This wasn't what I was thinking about, but we'll let the audience make up their own joke.
Okay, because I'm...
Whatever it is we're talking about. Here are my notes. Normally I do these on some sort of tablet, but I found it was much more efficient to scribble things out here on just a little pad of paper. We got some very good comments back on the episode 100. A lot of people seem to like episode 100.
Oh.
The our gala 100th anniversary.
We did nothing.
Yes, an episode of nothing. But sometimes the nothings, the on the road episodes that I did, all yep. were very popular. I forgot to start my stopwatch, so I know how long we're talking here. So, because you got to get out of here.
Yeah.
So those I thought would be like little throwaways. They were not hard to do. Not a lot of editing to them. I actually did them in the hotel room the night.
And they were popular.
They're very popular. People like them a lot. So maybe we need to
And you know why? Because it's like
Ham's doing ham stuff.
And not talking about doing ham stuff. That's yep. right.
Yep. So there's something I want to say about episode 100 I want to get right away. Cliff, W4FT, you did an awesome job of switching that show. Have you watched much of that show?
No.
I'm switching this show myself. I'm pushing.
I don't watch your shows.
No, I'm pushing my own buttons. But Cliff did a great job. I mean, he reaction shots, timing, anticipation. Every once in a while, I would catch in the corner of my eye, looking at the monitor, you know, something that didn't look right, and I would call his attention to it. Turns out, he knew what he was doing. He was very specifically switching to get reactions and stuff. So I would say something funny, you would be laughing. Okay, that happened once.
Okay, well, that's still good.
So, I'll show you an example because I can't do that while I'm actually talking and switching.
Okay.
I would say something funny, he would show you laughing.
Ah, that's good.
that's the way real television is supposed to work. So it takes a real... technical director / director to actually be able to do that stuff. Tougher when I'm switching myself.
He's doing it. You know, we almost never see him now.
No, he doesn't really like to be in front of the camera. Fortunately, there are people like that don't very much like to be in front of the camera or on the microphone. They like to do that background work. Most of my career has been doing that background work.
Mm-hmm.
Never really liked it. Well, I mean, it's not that I hated it, but I would always be envious of the people that were on camera. And so no one would ever put me on camera, so I put myself on camera.
Yeah, well, times change, and that explains a lot.
Yeah, and, you know, we've got the technology now where a lot of people can put themselves on camera, and some should be and some shouldn't be. And Cliff recognizes, I think he would actually do a better job than he thinks he would. But that's not where he wants to be. So
okay.
And well, the only reason he's not here is that Cliff is a night owl. When we go on trips, mm-hmm. I will, if you're going with me, we will get on the road at 6 o'clock, sometimes 5 o'clock. You know, I'll say, well, you'll say, what time are we going to leave? And I'll say, 5 o'clock. And you'll say, okay, well, if you want to sleep half the day away.
Yeah, we'll leave midday on your trips.
Yep. If I'm going with Cliff, it's I'll say, how about, because he's a night owl. He typically gets up at like noon. So like how about 9 o'clock? And you know, he'll go, oh,
Even bother? Wait till the next day. Leaving at 9, that's a pain worse than death for me.
We should leave it at 11 p.m. and, you know, drive all night, whatever, to get there.
So, oh, geez.
Anyway, so lots of good comments on the 101. We can look at a couple of them. A lot of them came from YouTube. Let me zip down toward the bottom of this thing here. And I won't read them all. I'll let you take a look. But for the listening audience, the folks that are only listening, this is one of those good radio shows that the video is... No, I take it back. This is not one of the good radio shows. This is one of the shows that you nearly need to watch because there's some field production in here and it's all pictures. So if you're listening to the audio, if you downloaded the audio, go find a way to get the picture.
You know, just looking at these comments, they like Cindy better than you.
They do, yeah. And they liked your hat. You weren't wearing this hat. You were wearing a Heil hat when we were trashing.
Oh, yeah. We were trashing?
Okay, I was trashing Ham Nation.
There we go.
And you were wearing a Heil hat. So yeah. I think that's what the nice hat is about. Yay, Cindy. So there were some people that made comments on the Ham Nation stuff, and I expected actually to get some heat about that, but I never did. Most of the few comments that we got, people were generally supportive. They liked what I did back on that show, and what I'm doing on this show, and you know, it's all good.
That's good. Yeah.
So,
well, you're doing something right.
You got fan mail from somebody. I don't have a copy of it here to put on screen, but. Yeah. You got someone who asked you a question.
Yeah, it was his name was Rick, and I can't remember his call sign, but it was very flattering. He inquired about my accent, and he said, "Please don't be offended." And that's very flattering. It's not offensive at all. But what really bothers me about it is I didn't have anything exotic to tell him.
Well, you don't think you have an accent, or do you?
No. Well, I don't think anybody thinks they do. Themselves. You hear it in others. You don't hear it in yourself.
Yeah. Do you think I have an accent? Do you hear it?
Very neutral.
Yeah. No. In theory, Midwestern, where I come from, born in Detroit, grew up in Chicago. I mean, there are Chicago accents. You know, them bears. I can't even do it because, you know, I didn't live in that part of Chicago.
Yeah. Them guys from Saturday Night Live were masters at it.
The Bears. But in theory, I've got that flat Midwestern newscaster pattern of speech.
Yeah.
But you have a little bit of pattern of speech. Now you grew up, you were born in Toledo.
Yeah.
So you should be as flat Midwestern as it comes.
Yeah, but I was like 7 when we moved from there, moved to Aberdeen Proving Grounds, Maryland, and grew up there.
So is that an accented place?
It's a slight southern accent, not a real heavy southern draw, just a little bit more southern than the Midwest accent. But I don't think that's where it came from. I was 19. I moved from there to North Carolina at 19 and then just started traveling everywhere for years after that with Mrs. Wittig. And I think this accent must have developed during those years of traveling.
So you're a polyglot.
What?
Now yeah. I'm offending him. Well, it's just a mishmash, you know, stew, a little bit of this, a little bit of that, all kind of poured in together. When I first met you, I got a very distinct impression of a style of speech. I thought you sounded like Arlo Gutherie.
Oh, yeah, and I've heard that many times over the years.
So we're going to test now.
Okay.
To see if you sound like Arlo Gutherie.
This song is called Alice's Restaurant. It's about Alice and the restaurant. But Alice's Restaurant is not the name of the restaurant. That's just the name of the song. And that's why I call the song Alice's Restaurant.
Okay, that's probably enough for us to tell. Can you imitate that? what do you folks out there think?
Just in my normal speech.
Yeah. Somebody's... yes, we have a guest. We have a guest host on the show.
Cindy tells me he was not the best of boys this morning.
No, he's been bad. We call him... When he's being bad, we call him a butt. He's been a butt. He was terrorizing Popoki. a cat that you'll probably never see here on the show. But anyway, we'll give him his limelight appearance.
The bear.
There you go, bear. Speaking of limelight appearances and animals and stuff, we should pick up the pig for a second. I always forget to do this at the beginning of the show. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. Sometimes it's brought to you by a Kickstarter, but not this one. This one is brought to you by you. If you like our shows, and occasionally people say they do.
Yeah.
None of this equipment is free. The only thing free in this entire room is Jeff.
And I'm not free. I work for food.
Yeah, his appearance here is courtesy of himself. Yeah. But everything else, including all of my time, takes real money. So stop by. Oh, yeah.
Tell me about the Naked Pig beer. Arvin's been drinking it over here. So
yeah, a viewer stopped by, I think it was our booth in Huntsville, and dropped that off. And said in a brown paper bag, said, don't open it here at the Ham Fest. And he said, it's for Arvin. It's in honor of Arvin. So.
Oh, nice. Okay. Naked Pig beer.
Yeah, so we won't be opening that.
From Gadsden, Alabama.
Yeah, I don't drink. You don't drink, I don't think.
Is that the home of the Gadsden flag?
I have no idea.
Oh.
Any case. And so we won't be tasting the Naked Pig. It's just, I guess maybe that's... it's Arvin or a relative.
I didn't even look at the pig.
On the bottle.
Oh, my goodness. It's a drunken pig.
All right. So stop by hamradionow.tv, our website. Or it says here, click the pig. What happens if you click the pig? You go to this rather awkward-looking site that says far more than it ought to say, and you can choose a contribution option. And then it takes you on to PayPal. You know, I have recently, as of the Kickstarter, had to set up an account with Amazon. And I don't know if people would prefer to pay by Amazon than PayPal. You know, some people don't like PayPal very much. So,
ask for feedback.
Yeah. So I'll do it if I have time. You know, when I get around to it. Set up a button for contributions from Amazon.
Okay.
I don't know how easy that will be either for me to do or for people to use, but we'll investigate that. Because if you contributed on the Kickstarter, you went through Amazon, but it's all credit card stuff. I mean, even the PayPal one, although they kind of push you toward using your PayPal account if you've got one, if you don't, or you don't want to use it, You keep pushing the credit card button. No credit card, no credit card, no credit card. And eventually you can use a credit card. And I don't see the credit card numbers. I don't see any of that stuff. I just get email and a web page telling me that somebody has sent a contribution. So,
What I can tell you is I don't often contribute to hamradionow.tv, but when I do,
you did once.
I use PayPal.
you're auditioning for another commercial, aren't you?
I like that guy.
Yeah. He's the world's most interesting. They had a sign at, I think it was Huntsville. You remember that?
The DX guy.
Yeah. Yeah, they had a big cutout picture of him with the caption that said, I don't often operate, when I do, I work DX or something. It certainly wasn't QRP.
Like that. I think that's what it was, yeah.
It certainly was. I don't operate ham radio much, but when I do, it's QRP. He did not
That wouldn't be the world's most interesting man.
No, the world's most low-power guy.
Yeah.
All right, so let's see. What else on my notes? So we've taken care of your accent. Some people have asked me about doing some specific types of programs. One fellow really wants me to do an in-depth review of the Flex radios. And other people would like to see us do in-depth reviews of stuff. You know, Ham's doing Ham stuff, figuring out all this stuff. That is actually kind of beyond our ability. Hmm. We would have to acquire the radios, bring them in here, set them up. You could probably do a better job than I do in terms of ringing them out. And I know they'd be popular, but there's a lot of background work involved in doing that.
Yep.
So I don't know that we're going to do that kind of thing. Oh, I've got your picture on.
I came pretty close to having one to review. When we got back from Dayton, I really wanted one and read everything I could find on that Signature 6000 series, but it just sounded like it had too many bugs still to risk that kind of expenditure. So I thought I'd give it a little more time and see what I heard.
Well, as it happens, I have a friend here in town who is sitting waiting for the UPS man or FedEx man to deliver his 6500. So possibly when he gets that and gets a chance to understand it a little bit better, I'll go over there to tote a camera and we'll try to ring that out. But it's not something we're going to be able to do with every radio that comes out on the market.
Well, you know, the Flex, that's not like any radio we've seen before. It's completely different generation, an evolutionary step, so to speak. So, you know, don't do every SDR. But if you're going to do one, you don't often review SDRs, but when you do...
review the Flex. Yeah. Well, you know, Flex is... And I'm in an awkward position now because Flex is a sponsor, an underwriter of the Tapper stuff, and so is Elecraft.
Right.
So the two big SDR companies. And I want to maintain independence from, you know, editorial independence in the program from their influence. People have said that Hamnation is like sold out to Icomm. Mm-hmm. Although they look at other brands and other stuff, but I got some of that pressure when I was doing Hamnation way back in the early days that, you know, that don't talk. I got one specific thing. Don't talk about that other brand. Wow. It wasn't only talk about Icomm, but I had done a little feature video on some other radio, and I got a don't. And I had put it on the show without authorization. I just put it on.
And, that explains why you're not there anymore.
could be. I got spanked a little bit for it. I don't think that's their editorial position anymore, but clearly Icomm is a huge sponsor. Yeah. And I want to avoid that while still being able to accept underwriting. I call it underwriting because we don't have a big enough audience for advertising. Advertising is sort of measured in the cost per thousand, you know, how much you pay for how many thousand impressions you get.
Yeah.
We only get 1,000 impressions, maybe 2,000 or 3,000 on some of our more popular shows. So we can't really justify someone advertising, at least not at this point.
Right.
Not to the point where it's going to actually bring in enough revenue. So we call it underwriting. And underwriting is, to me, and probably not the PBS official line, but underwriting to me is advertising that isn't worth it.
Man. The only motorcycle magazine that I read is one that has no advertisements in it. It's printed in black and white.
Yeah.
But it's great. It's great. And no ads. You know, nothing is colored. Everything is as they review it.
Yeah, and Consumer Reports are like that. They take no advertising, and they make a big deal out of it. But they make their money somehow. They make their money by selling subscriptions to the magazines and the website and doing the kind of begging that we do for contributions. Yeah. So, you know, somehow, it's like I always say, when I go to McDonald's and order a Happy Meal, I can't hand them a video. they want money.
Yeah.
So, however, speaking of video productions here on Ham Radio Now, I have not thought of this in depth yet. So this is a off the top of my head kind of thing.
Okay.
But I would like to invite viewers to make videos for Ham Radio Now. Now, Ham Nation has been soliciting videos from their audience for a while, and they got Dale Puckett on there now, who rounds them up, does a little editing, trimming on them, and gets them on. They had Julian Frost. I don't know what happened to Julian. He just kind of disappeared the way I did. Maybe his choice, maybe not. I have no idea. Anyway, Dale Puckett is on there, but what he's drumming into people's heads is a minute and a half to 2 minutes. Short. So, and his initial videos, he got 5, 6, 10 minutes, and he had to whack them down or go back to the people who made them and get them to whack them down. And now he's getting stuff real short. Well, guess what? we don't have to be short. No one has ever accused us of being short. But there is something I'd like to say about doing videos for Ham Radio Now. If you would like to become like a Ham Radio Now segment producer of some kind, don't do a video about what you're doing. Do a video about what somebody else is doing. If you're doing something you think would be interesting, get somebody else to do the video, somebody who really knows how, and bring the production quality up. Do I dare say the standards of our program?
Well, you can. But you know, what you're asking for is exactly what I've been trying to do now for like 2 years.
Well, you've been trying to get me to do videos of you doing stuff.
Yeah.
And that's the wrong person to ask because I don't have time, clearly.
Yeah, well, if you want something done, you got to find a busy person to do it.
So we need to find another video producer here to produce your stuff.
And that'll work for free.
Yeah, it'll work for free. That's the other thing about it is we're not going to be paying anybody for any of this stuff, excuse me, anytime soon. So you'll be working for honor, joy, publicity, recognition, fame, but not riches.
I have a video to bring you, to show you. It's 15 minutes.
Okay.
But cool. It's exactly what you said not to do. Made it myself.
Well, and
did everything.
We're probably going to get more of that. That's, you know, hams do that. Hams are in that mode of produce it yourself. Most of the writing that you see in QST, QAX, CQ, are people writing about what they did. So they may be a good doer and not so good a writer. They may be a good writer, but what they're writing about is you know. So what I'm saying, and we've done some programs that were us doing things and us doing video about what we were doing, because as it so happens, we have some skills. Yeah, we've got some skills.
Yeah,
I've got the video skills and I've got some ham radio skills, and you've got mad ham radio and engineering skills. So between the two of us, we've licked the platter clean, but we can't do it all. So if you're interested in doing something like this, what camera am I looking at there? That one. If you're interested in doing something like this, again, this is early days, drop me a line, kn4aq@arvn.tv. And let me know what your thoughts are. But I could use some bureaus, you know, around the country. I could use people producing things other places than here and other places that I can travel to, that I can't travel to, and keep it interesting. And probably a fully produced program, edited top to bottom. You can even do the intro and the close if you know how to say over.
And out.
You can.
But no, no, not now, not now.
Oh, no, we're not done yet. You could do that. But there's some other options too. You could give me a produced piece, 10, 15, 30, an hour, and then we can talk on Skype for a couple minutes and do an intro and a close with a short talking to you, not you, but you on Skype, and I can contribute that much, and then it can be a Ham Radio Now episode.
If people won't do it, then we'll have to introduce it. don't want that.
Yeah, you don't want that. And, you know, the internet has got unlimited capacity, and we can put up a show every day. That means that not everybody can watch every show. Not everybody watches every show now, but we can certainly put up more content than I can cram through my editing system. And today's show, which we'll get to eventually, is an example of why there's been almost a week, more than a week passed by between the last show, episode 100, and 101. I spent the week editing the pieces that are going to go into this, which is going to show.
A year old.
Yeah.
Some of it.
some of it's over a year old. How are we doing on time?
Oh, we're
doing.
He's happy to be bringing it to you now, though.
Yeah, we're way over time here.
Okay.
One last thing I want to bring up before we get to today's stuff. And that is, the Kickstarter was very successful in getting me out to Seattle to record the Tapper stuff. So I'm thinking, how can I go to this well again without running it dry? And what will be the best uses of a Kickstarter to let people fund things that we're going to do. Kickstarter, and there's other things. There's Indiegogo. There's other ways to do it that are less restrictive. Kickstarter's got a specific restriction that it is a specific project with a beginning and an end.
Right.
So you can't just fund an ongoing thing. I can't do a Kickstarter to fund. I could try a year of production of Ham Radio Now. I don't think Kickstarter's going to go for that.
I don't think your viewers would go for that. But the Tapper people, if your question is, what will you do? What will the project be? They came to you, right?
Well, that was a long time ago. They came to me years ago. And then I was looking for a way to get funding for the Tapper videos that I would be doing this year better than what the way they had been funded before, selling DVDs, which got sort of okay.
Right.
And then online contributions in the 2 years I did online, which was sort of a bust, you know, just terrible.
I think you should ask viewers what they want to see.
That sounds extremely dangerous, but we can try that. But the ideas that I had, the specific projects, we've been going to Hamfests.
Right.
We've been going to Orlando, Dayton, Huntsville. I would like to add Dallas. And I would like to add a West Coast Hamfest or two, Pacificon, CPAC. I get invitations to Hamfest all over the place, but no way I can go to most of them. But a few of the big ones we could go to. But they have to be funded. So I'm thinking they could be specific projects. Funding to the next one is Orlando. And to commit to a booth in Orlando has to be fairly soon. So the Kickstarter would have to start pretty soon. So what I'll do is I'll work up a budget in the next week or so and figure out what it costs to do that and then add in something for editing time and see how big a Kickstarter that's got to be and launch it, and we'll just see how it does. You know, we'll see if it gets a reaction. I'll put in a corporate level like I did, and we'll see if we can get some businesses to sign on. Not the $2,000 corporate level, probably. And just way off the top of my head, I'm thinking it's going to be a $3,000 to $5,000 Kickstarter, with a handful of $500 corporates and then individuals, and we'll see how they do. We'll see how people really want us to be able to produce programs here for Ham Radio Now.
Okay.
So what we better do now is stop yammering.
All right.
And get on with the business at hand.
Okay. What are we talking about?
All right. Well, it's a tale of two Emcomm vehicles.
Right.
I would like to say a tale of two Emcomms, but that doesn't really say enough.
No, it doesn't.
So on episode 101, I had said that Cliff went to Orlando with me, which he did the first year, but not the second year. You went there the second year.
Right, right.
And we did a bunch of interviews. The interviews have all been on for a long time. But we also walked around a bit and shot some stuff. Yeah. And one of the things that we shot was a magnificent Emcomm vehicle that the hams in Brevard County had put together. And I don't say very much about that because that's what what we're going to show, we'll talk about. What I do want to talk about very briefly is that maybe a decade ago, and I'm not sure you were involved in our local radio club, the Raleigh Club, or not at that point, somebody offered us a used, very used TV truck.
Yeah.
One of the minicam trucks.
Yeah, I was the secretary then.
Okay.
I came on board at our local club in 92 and was the secretary from 94 for 8 years after that.
All right. So a local TV station, I think it was Channel 5, WRAL, had a truck they were going to surplus. And rather than sell it out there on the market, they would strip it, leave in the generator, and leave in the big mast that sends stuff up. And it all sounds very intriguing. And so we talked about it at a board of directors meeting, and everybody was
many board of directors meetings.
Yeah, I wasted a lot of time.
Yeah.
People were very excited about the concept.
Well, the concept, yeah.
Yeah. Until was it you or me or who threw cold water on everything?
What? Well, bringing up the cost of maintaining it and who's going to maintain it and where it's going to be kept, all the logistical stuff was just...
The devil was in the details. And no one had good answers for that.
They were big details, though.
And that happens a lot at radio clubs. Someone will come up with a great idea, But they don't want to be the one to
follow
through. That
everybody else should do.
Yeah, right. Somebody. We should do this. Mm-hmm. We should fill in the blank.
Yeah. And
one of the most popular ones is, we should get more kids in ham radio. And, but no, yeah, but nobody steps up to actually do
we'd
that.
We'd all like to. It's just not easy to do.
Yeah. So the local club had that offer, which the smartest thing in the world we did was decline it because no one was going to step up and do that. You'll see that as a recurring theme in these two interviews. The first one from Florida, from Brevard County,
right.
And the second one in a club that has even deeper resources, the Dayton Amateur Radio Association, yeah. The folks that put on the Hamvention. They built a gem.
Yeah,
so,
yeah, but both have a serious commitment to the vehicle.
Yeah,
and that's what's required.
Yeah, and so I asked about that and got answers, and so that's what people should pay attention to as they are salivating over these magnificent vehicles. That's one of the questions. The other is, what are you going to do with it? You know, what are you really going to do?
And that question was really well answered through the questions you asked, too.
Yep. So let's head down to Brevard County first and check out their Emcomm Spectacular.
Let's go.
Who am I talking to?
My name is Ozzie, O-Z-Z-I-E. My call sign is N4SCY.
And do you have like a position, a title or something?
Right now I'm the driver of the Bears One vehicle. And I also operate out of it.
Okay, we'll figure out what that is in a minute.
Sure.
You, we talked to last year.
Exactly, yes, Carlos.
Tell everybody who you are again.
I am Carlos Checker, K4CCJ. I'm a member of the Bears in Brevard County for the emergency services.
All right. We are standing in front of a pretty impressive vehicle.
Thank you.
Give me the elevator pitch about it, 30 sure. seconds or so.
This is Bears One. Bears is the Brevard Emergency Amateur Radio Service. And basically, our emergency manager in Brevard County wanted a single point of contact to contact ham radio when he needed us. As a result, the clubs got together and created Bears as the organization. We had a number of people with their own RVs and equipment with radios in them that we would take to various events, field day, what have you. They were getting old, decrepit, and one lady in our group decided to put through a grant with the state of New York. And she generated this grant, sent it
New
in.
New York. You said New York.
Oh, no, I'm sorry. I'm not sure why it came out that way, but no. She did some grantsmanship and sent it up to Tallahassee, to the state of Florida.
Florida. Okay, so you're from, I bet you're from New York.
Rochester, New York, yes, with 10 years in the city on the way down.
Yeah, because Florida, as we all know, is a suburb of New York.
No, South Florida is a suburb of New York.
Well, where's Brevard County?
Brevard County is on the Space Coast. Brevard County has the Kennedy Space Center and the Cape Canaveral Air Force Station. Collectively, I think of them as the Canaveral Spaceport.
Okay, so you got a grant and bought a big truck.
Didn't just buy a big RV. We went to North American Catastrophe Services, a company in Brevard County that makes command post vehicles for various agencies and even the federal government. Our pile of money wasn't enough, but we said, listen, we'll put in some sweat equity as well. Well, members of our club, a number of them are ex-NASA employees, retired. Some of them are even retired NASA program managers. So we had some real expertise among us, to the point where North American Catastrophe Services were looking over our shoulders. Our guy was playing with his CAD cam one day. Now they use that CAD cam system. So we learned from each other.
You're making inroads every place with these guys.
Absolutely.
This looks to me like something a county would have, not for ham radio, for the county.
True. And in fact, we have been dispatched on behalf of the county. We had some wildfires down in the south end a few years back. And the fire chief was used to the kind of schlocky, you know, broken down stuff the county usually sends him. When we showed up in Bears One, he fell in love. And he was very happy with what we could do. We put up our tower with our pan tilt zoom camera on it. He could look around and see where the fires were and dispatch his troops. He was extremely happy with us.
Now, before I forget this question, Bears One, is that in hopes of a Bears Two or is there a Bears Two?
Well, we started out with Comm One, and a couple of one guy came up with his RV, and he was Comm Two, then Comm Three. The Comm Three, well, when we became Bears One, because We then formed Bears, the Brevard Emergency Amateur Radio Service. So this vehicle became Bears 1 instead of Comm 1. So Bears Comm 3 then became Bears 3. There is no...
This is getting far more complex than we need to get. So you got a grant money that partially funded it. You had a bunch of interested people. How did you get the human element into it? These things, when they start at radio clubs, they start, somebody's got a great idea, and they rope somebody else into it, but it doesn't really go anywhere, or it falls apart because you don't get enough people. How did you get what it takes to get here?
We're just very lucky. We have enough people to be the critical mass to keep it running. We have meetings every Monday morning at 9 a.m. to go over the vehicle, maintain it, make sure that the tire pressure is okay, the oil is checked, and this, that, and the other, all the little things you need to do.
You got a good place to keep it?
We do. We've got someone's home where he's got the fellow who started off with Comm 1. His RV broke down. He was getting too old to maintain his own. That's where we park Bears 1, where he's got the shoreline power that we use to keep it going, keep the air conditioning going so that Bears 1 doesn't fall down from the inside. And that's where our meetings are every Monday morning at 9. By 11 a.m., we're all getting a little antsy to get down to the local restaurant for lunch. And
you say every Monday morning?
Every Monday morning.
So this is retired people?
Mostly, yes. Some working people who don't have as much time, but they'll come out when we have events. We are actually tasked by Brevard County to go out to a site on State Route 528, just south of Cape Canaveral Air Force Station, for every launch to be eyes and ears on the ground should something go wrong.
And that's an important thing because you need to keep things moving. You need to practice and know what's going on.
Exactly. It keeps the vehicle fresh. We get to set things up, see what breaks down, see what needs to be fixed, see what needs to be repaired. And every once in a while, there is no launch during a particular month. We'll take it out to a local park and run a practice exercise just to keep the bus, going and making sure that it's still operational and working.
What's the job during the launch?
During the launch, it's mostly inform the tourists, really. One of the constituent clubs is LISAT, the Launch Information Service and Amateur Television System. That's the group that takes the bus out for the launches. So on our repeater on 146.940 megahertz, we always bring up the auto patch to NASA or the Air Force and put the NASA feed over the repeater. We then pick it up inside the bus and put it out over the speakers that are fore and aft so that the assembled tourists can find out what's going on.
And is duty on this thing a coveted position? You're probably not beating people off with sticks, but do you have enough volunteers that really fill it up?
We do. There are enough hams in Brevard County, and among the retirees, they're all looking for something to do anyway, most of them. And so this is something they can do that actually makes a difference. So we have enough of those kinds of people that come out to help out on the Monday mornings, and will come out for the launches as well. And then if a particular club has an event going on where the use of the vehicle would be important, they apply to Bears, and if no one else has signed up for it for that period of time, they have to have a driver who's qualified to drive it. We've got our own instructor who qualifies people, and then their club member can take the bus out to their event. Field day, usually, it depends who applies first to get the bus for field day. And
Have people who have used it taken good care of it?
Generally, yeah.
Generally?
And, yeah. When they don't get the bus anymore. when the Palm Bay fire chief was through with the bus, he had his firemen go in and give it a spick and span cleaning and wash the outside. It came back much better than it left.
So there's got to be some ongoing expenses besides just gas and stuff, maintenance. But how do you handle that?
We do some fundraising. Yeah, insurance is the biggest expense. Fuel, not so much, because each group that takes the bus out pays for their gas. For the launches, since we're dispatched by the county, we go to the county fuel point and we load up on their gas. I've just completed a week in Camp Blanding, a National Guard camp in North Florida, big training base. We had a statewide radio interoperability exercise up there, and included some feds as well. The state of Florida realizes that when things fall down, the people who have radios need to talk to each other. And some of those radios don't talk to each other. In fact, at one point in the exercise, they had everyone shut down their generators, shut down their repeaters, and start an Aries net. And sure enough, enough of the agencies had a ham within their agency that we could bring up an Aries net to link all of those agencies.
So they actually tried a all ham radio communications. For how long did they do it?
Oh, that was a brief, it was one single task. So it was very brief. Once we had the network up and could prove to them that we could maintain that network, that's fine. That accomplished the task. We moved on to something else.
We make lots of claims. We don't often have to back them up. You had to back it up this time.
Oh, we did. In fact, we were given one task to provide a video signal back to the COML, the communications leader. Well, we had our camera going on the tower. All we do is throw the switch to the transmitter on. Sir, you should have signal now, K4EOC Mobile 1. He didn't have a signal. Went over to his trailer, looked at the TV set. We couldn't see anything. Came back to Bears 1, pulled out our TV set, walked it over to the COML's trailer, turned it on and said, "See, we're putting out a signal. If you can't pick it up, it's not our problem."
What was the problem? Did you trace it down?
No, but I suspect that their new digital TVs are not set up to see the cable channels over an antenna.
Oh, yeah.
Because that's where ham ATV is in that cable TV band that your cable box picks up, but is not usually seen.
Yeah, it was probably there, but they probably didn't set it up right.
Or didn't know how to program it right or something. But in the meantime, we showed them, yes, we're demonstrating that we've accomplished the task.
So I want to ask, what is all inside in terms of communications equipment and logistics and human element? But first, in terms of interoperability, is it all ham radio, or do you have some other communication services besides the CB radio I saw in there?
We have other radios in there. We have a Red Cross radio. We have Marine Band. And as you say, we have CB as well. We're not proud. We're out there to communicate. And when things fall down, you need to bring in stuff in large trucks. Golly, what kind of radios do the truckers have? And we know to come up on Channel 19.
And that's smart. Hams these days, if they're CB, they just don't get it.
We're here to communicate, and...
Okay, so what have you got inside for ham radio?
For ham radio, we've got VHF, UHF, HF. We've got packet radio. Also on the computers, we've got RMS Express, which allows us to do WinLink. Now, WinLink is an interesting system because it's real email. Standard SMTP, Simple Mail Transfer Protocol. The software sets up a telnet link over radio, not over telephone lines.
To a certain segment of the audience, we may be speaking Klingon now.
It's quite possible. But in the computer communications world, telnet is a form of internet transfer. It's a simple serial connection for just, data going in both directions. No graphics, nothing fancy, but in a disaster situation, all you want is very simple communications, nothing fancy to get that message out.
So without building the watch, as I understand it, it lets you get a Wi-Fi signal out to their computers.
No, not even Wi-Fi. It's simply enter an email message, enter as many as you want. It's posted to the outbox. Then you open a session, a telnet session, to the WinLink node in your area via packet radio. That node has an internet connection, which then sends the email out. Simple mail transfer protocol, SMTP, the simplest form of email between computers. And it also checks the remote host to see if there's any incoming mail for us.
And this is done on VHF or UHF packet system?
Typically VHF packet. However, there are also HF gateways as well. So ham radio becomes...
So if you've got a big disaster area that's too far for any VHF link, then you can go to HF, although that's going to be slower, I guess.
It will be a little slower, but in this kind of situation, slow is better than a dead stop.
Yeah.
I also explained about packet radio. It's 1,200 baud, 1.2K. Consider a telephone dial-up, it's 56K. So again, we're talking slow. This is not the information superhighway, but I consider it the information super bicycle path. And boy, can you go off-road.
That's a good analogy. And I think I've made that point. It's not fast, but it's faster than zero.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. Do you think the digital modes are more important than voice these days? How do you divvy up the responsibilities of these various modes you can use?
It's however you get a message out. And the thing is that the digital modes are becoming important because the served agencies understand them. They understand an email, where they don't understand that scrap of paper with something scrawled on it with that message that came in.
Yeah, they want their email back.
That's true. And that's what WinLink does for us, is it allows us to have formatted emails that looks like something that came in off the internet.
But you still have a need for tactical voice communications.
Oh, absolutely. Because setting up the networks and like that is using your handy talkies and your mobile rigs to get everything set up, working, and then hopefully you can go into the digital mode if you've got it, pass some traffic for your served agency. That's what we're out there for, is to serve the agencies.
Do your members get into using all these various modes? Do you have to do training and get people up to speed on things besides just talking on their handy talkie with a half-dead battery?
Actually, this camp landing exercise was a perfect example because I'm in position 3 working packet. My buddy next to me in position 4 was working HF. He's also a Mars operator, so he's able to get into the Mars net. We passed some traffic that way. We were given one task of contacting the state warning point. Well, I've got a phone number in my Palm Pilot that I've had in there for years. I've never needed to use or look at, and all of a sudden, I needed the phone number. He got out a phone patch through Mars, and we called the state warning point. Completed the task.
When did you build this thing? How long has it been in operation?
It was commissioned in 2006, and keeping it up and maintained, we've got a group that meets every Monday morning at 9 a.m.
McDonald's?
No, someone's house. It's where the Bears one is based. And by 11 o'clock, we're getting antsy to get down to the Beef O'Brady's and get some lunch.
What kind of, in the course of its existence, what kind of actual deployment has it had besides the NASA thing?
We've been very fortunate. The 2004 hurricanes that came through Florida, the multiple hurricanes that year, I think was the reason that our grant finally got through. And we've been very fortunate that we haven't had major events like that since. So it's mostly been Field Day, Hamfests, launches, and those are the big things that the vehicle comes out for.
What have you learned that surprised you, that made you make changes, that especially things that you can pass on to people who might think this is a cool thing to do? What kind of things have you learned that you were not expecting to be the case?
Well, I would say be certain that you have a bunch of people who are willing to help you maintain it, and the fundraising capabilities to raise the funds as well, not only to maintain the little things that go wrong, the oil changes now and again, what have you, but the insurance right now is the biggest expense. Tires, when we have to go for new tires, that gets to be a big expense on the vehicle this large as well.
See, on the back, there's a sign with some corporate sponsors. You do have some sponsorship?
We did get some sponsors early on, and they were able to help us with some of the early funding that we needed to, you know, put the thing together. We do go looking for corporate sponsors to cover things like insurance and oil and other maintenance items and things like that.
Operationally, did it do what you intended it to do right off the bat, or have you altered things to make it work better?
Well, we've had to rewrite some of the documentation. We've had to move some things around where we got interference from one radio to another radio. We've moved the antennas on the roof.
Field Day taught you that.
Oh, yeah. But Field Day is a great training exercise. I maintain to this day that the skills I used in Homestead after Hurricane Andrew, I learned on Field Day.
Are the modes and equipment all the same from day one, or have you adjusted to as new things have come along? D-Star didn't exist, or just barely existed back then.
Well, we don't have D-Star on board. It's one operating mode we don't have. I've heard that the D-Star does not do AX and NAX very well in data modes, and being a data guy, I want a data mode that's going to work. So I'm sticking with my AFSK packet radio.
Okay, you're going to hear from some D-Star people. Email address is?
N4SCY at amsat.org. Be happy to receive those mails. But really, until you can convince me, I can send, you know, files that way and make sure.
They get pretty excited about a program called D-Rats, but I'm not an expert in it, so I'll let them contact you.
Well, when I can afford the radios, too, then I'll consider it a lot more as well.
Yeah. Where you got any plans for the future? Any place you're thinking about this thing is going to go? Or just more of the same?
More of the same, because hopefully we won't have the kind of disaster where it would be called out. But if there is...
You're in Florida, dude.
Yeah, I know. And we're ready.
That was amazing. They did great.
Yes, the evolution, I mean, this thing is a dozen years or 6 years old, and the evolution has been wonderful.
Yep. There's one thing that Ozzy said that has caught my attention that I want to bring up, and hopefully it won't make him mad at me. But he was talking about sending that video signal out to the emergency manager.
Right.
And they weren't able to get it.
Right.
And he said, it's not our problem.
Well, he saw the signal. Well, yeah. And I know what you're getting at, and yeah. I agree with you.
Yeah, it is our problem end to end. And I didn't call him on it because I wasn't thinking about it at the time. I didn't think about it until I was putting this piece together. If I had talked to him about it for another 10 seconds, he probably would have said, yeah, it's our problem end to end.
Yeah. When the communication doesn't work, it's our problem. And we want to make it work.
That's what we're there for.
That's right. That's right. And it's easy to say, you know, well, our equipment is working. We're doing what we're supposed to do. We're transmitting. But that doesn't mean we've completed the job. When they can communicate, you know, when we provide the communications on behalf of the agency, then we're successful.
And you know, the idea of, well, our part worked is a bit of a ham radio / engineering attitude.
You know, 35 years I worked at a communications company, and 25 of those years was in telephone communications. And the biggest problem was that, you know, the trouble's leaving here fine.
Yeah, yeah. In my business and doing television, the little bit of stuff I did that had anything to do with a network or whatever, you know, when something didn't arrive at the other end, well, it looks okay leaving here. Yeah. But I like your way of saying it better. The trouble's leaving here fine.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and then, you know, everyone's pointing fingers to, as opposed to tracking down where the missing link is and getting it fixed as fast as possible.
Yeah. Right.
So we need to understand it's hams. We look best if we go after the missing link immediately and go and fix it. Or even better if it's the missing link is never shows up.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
All right, so if you thought that one was impressive, take a look at this one.
Let's go to Dayton.
This is the Dara Communications vehicle. It used to be originally a 2001 Mack tool truck. We had a local contractor who puts together all of the Mack tool trucks for the United States, tear it apart, go through it mechanically, bit by bit to make sure everything is mechanically straight, and help build the infrastructure that you see throughout the vehicle. They took a lot of pride and ownership in building this, and they were very, very meticulous in doing the job. We have been doing this for over a year as far as building it, and within the last 8 weeks, we have populated all the equipment within the vehicle and have actually used it one time prior to this as a shakedown cruise for a bicycle race. And we found some minor issues, which is to be expected, but we've shaken those out and we're building on it. But it's been a labor of love, and it's a fantastic environment to show amateur radio in a good form, and take it out and also provide emergency communications during any type of disaster situation. We have internet capability. We have with a 1.2 gig D-Star radio. We have audiovisual capability. We have a 65-inch outside television screen that we can display any of our maps, APRS data, and so forth. We have APRS capability, digipeater capability on the inside. We also have computers so we can monitor, display, those kind of things. And of course, it's got 2-meter, 440 HF radios all through it. We are going to get more. We have a flex radio. HF radio and ICOM 7000 HF radio, and we have Step IR, which we can reach out to and touch people all over the world, and a vertical Tar Heel antenna, so HF antenna that we can do. We have 28 ports on the top of the vehicle, which provides us a multitude of antenna connections that we can plug up with our patch panels and put any type of radio on an antenna. Sounds like they're up on the roof tearing down the antenna. Everything is powered off of either shoreline. We can do shoreline, which we have some very big heavy-duty batteries down below, but we also have a 12 kilowatt generator on board. It's actually running now, and with the doors open, you can barely hear it. I don't know if you can hear it in the background over my voice. if you take a look in the cab, our driver has radio communications, also has APRS capability with a D710, and our co-driver, which we always have two drivers on board, has the capability to communicate as well. We also have the capability on board to track individuals as, say, a tail end Charlie or lead vehicles or emergency vehicles, or, and we've used in the past, Greene County Sheriff's horse, Greene County Sheriff's posse, where they go out and are searching for people in the field. We strap on these all-in-one radios, which are APS tracking devices, and we can track them via APRS. And in fact, they have come in handy in the past. We had one horse rider that fell off their horse. They didn't know where exactly we were at, but we had APRS on that horse. They found the individual, got him the medical care that needed. We want to do a lot of public service events. I am the Air Force, U.S. Air Force Marathon Amateur Radio Coordinator. We're going to use it for that. So that type of event, a marathon, or other public service events. We've used it for a bike race, like I said earlier. We're also going to take it to schools. Whatever we can, whatever the need arises, we'll take it there. We were lucky enough to get to keep the vehicle in a Fairborn fire station. Fairborn, Ohio had a fire station with six bays, and some of the bays were empty. So we actually get to keep that inside it. And we have a crew right now that we're building on, about 20 to 30 actually helped build it. And we're now getting crews together to help drive it and so forth. Right now we only have about four people who are authorized to drive it. We're still building a training programs on everything we'll need. And we have all aspects of amateur or emergency responses represented in our crew. We have truck drivers. We've got police and fire individuals. We have an emergency manager. I spent 18 years as an emergency manager. We have electricians. We have a vehicle maintenance specialist. So it's we have a multitude of people on board that can help us maintain this vehicle. It was funded by you, amateur radio individuals that come to Dayton Hamvention. We appreciate it. We take part of the funding that comes from our tickets, from our Hamvention sales, and we put it into this vehicle. But we also use our money other ways, like yesterday we gave out $49,000 in scholarships. But it's a portion of your ticket, of the revenue that we receive from Hamvention to help build this vehicle. And we wanted to make sure it was done right, so it shows amateur radio in a very good light.
Quit drooling.
Yeah, the operating positions looked very comfortable.
Yeah. So Adara's got, you know, money to spend, and now that the Hamfest is back well into the black again, they're they're doing well. So, you know, they can do things like that. You know, our club, no way. I mean,
I wish we could. Every club wishes they could, but the fact is that it takes a lot of resources.
Yeah, but you've also got to have a purpose for them. And I think in both of these, we've seen that the wonderful idea behind them is not often realized in practice.
Right.
Because there's just not that many uses for it. And when you get something, you know, some kind of big disaster, and you get it out there, and that, you know, that really justifies all the work. And if you haven't done the work, well, then you don't have the resources.
Yeah.
So you need to constantly come up with things. And these guys talked about it, field day, other activities.
Well, yeah, the Brevard, they've got a schedule for their vehicle.
Yeah, they've got an interesting utility every month. So good thing to do. So you kind of have to do that. And I think the other problem is keeping everybody's interest up. I've seen that not so much in vehicles like this, but in museum stations. There are some very successful, well put together museum stations, but there's others that have had trouble keeping the interest up. And I'm thinking of specifically one just down the road from us in Charlotte, a Discovery Place, where a few people took on the task of keeping it going all the time. And the rest of the club went, "We love this. It looks great, but no, I don't have time to go help."
Right. That's right.
So it eventually, the museum did some reorg and said, we don't see a need for this. So they closed the station. Very sad.
Yeah, it's sad, but I mean, I can sure understand why they had to do it.
Yep. So moving on, we had some other things that we did. This is back at Dayton that I haven't had time to edit yet.
We ate too many hamburgers. Well,
yes.
Well, one of us did.
Well, we did a tour. We got a tour out on Friday, mostly out in the flea market, mm-hmm. which is a place that we often don't get to spend very much time.
Right.
And then we did an introduction for a tour on Saturday and never got out into anywhere in the Hamfest on Saturday. We did interviews for the entire day. So we tried again on Sunday. We did an introduction on Sunday thinking that we wouldn't have a lot of other interviews to do. And, well, interviews came our way. Yeah. So we had this interview or this introduction on Sunday. But the reason I want to play it, even though it introduces nothing, is that we had a guest for the introduction, a little mini interview is part of the introduction.
I don't even remember.
A high-profile guest, a celebrity guest. And that person, we also did a full-on interview, which has been on for a long time. But the introduction to the program and the conversation we had, I thought was somewhere between worthwhile and cute.
Okay, let's see it.
So it's good. So
I don't remember.
Let's take a look. Ham Radio Now from the Dayton Hamvention. 500. Not the Dayton 500. It's the Hamvention.
No.
I've been screwing up the name of the Hamfest all weekend long.
You have called it Hamcation. You haven't called it Hamboree.
Yep. We have a guest here for our goofy little opening.
We do.
And then we'll do a real serious interview. Kay Craigie, president of the ARRL. Welcome to Ham Radio Now.
Thank you, Gary.
Oh, you may not thank me when we're done. You may. I don't know. We'll find out. You've seen the interviews I've done with some of the other ARRL folks. So, maybe you haven't. I don't know. Do they force you to watch the stuff I do?
Yeah, I don't think I've ever seen one of your interviews before.
I've talked to everybody who's top level except for you. I've talked to Dave Sumner and Harold
Kramer.
Hal Kramer and Bob Interbitson and Mike Corey. So finally working my way up to the top.
I don't know about that, but it's fun to be in that company.
Yep. Well, so we'll do the ARRL interview in just a minute. Right now we're starting out our Sunday. We did an opening for Saturday, intending mm-hmm. to walk around the Hamfest, carry the cameras around, and look at stuff, and then we sat down here and we did interviews until like 3 o'clock.
Well, but that wasn't the only thing that held us up from wandering around. We had lots of visitors come by.
Oh, that's true. Yeah, we are. I don't know where you've been, but we're big television stars here now.
Well, I think that's wonderful. I've been working in the non-virtual world at the other end of the aisle here. I need a hand transplant for having shaken hands with thousands of people, and I definitely need a foot transplant. A
couple more bottles of Purell, probably.
I've gone through a bit of it this weekend. not to insult our colleagues, but, microbes are microbes.
Well, people understand health issues nowadays.
Yeah, sure. I don't shake hands. I started doing the Howie Mandel fist bump thing, and it seems to help a lot. And people are accepting that these days, for the most part. I don't seem to be too upset about it. So we never did get around to the Hamfest. We did our flea market stuff on Friday.
We'll try again today.
Yeah, we'll try, because this is the only interview we got lined up. And Sunday is a quieter day.
Yeah.
I always say that Sunday's Dayton is bigger than any other Hamfest is on its best day, except for maybe Orlando or a couple of the other big ones. But just about every other Hamfest out there would kill to have Dayton's Sunday.
Yeah.
Whereas almost every other Hamfest we go to, if they're a 3-day or 2-day Hamfest, Sunday's dead. Nothing's happening. But even here, it's still a good day to come if you want to get a little more attention from manufacturers, reps, ARRL presidents. The line to talk to you would not be quite so long.
Probably not. Maybe measure it in the hundreds instead of the thousands. But you can also get great bargains here on a Sunday because people are ready to pack up and they want to see what they can do about their inventory before they have to pack it and ship it.
Yeah. And now you've probably missed the flea market. Just about anything worthwhile
today,
out there.
Yeah.
It's going to be pretty well collapsing.
Mm-hmm.
Yesterday, it rained hard in the morning. Some of the interviews that if you watch them, you'll see people walking by with ponchos. And around 10 or 11 o'clock, this place got absolutely wall-to-wall. You couldn't walk across the aisle. And
like I've said before, you couldn't stir them with a stick in here.
Yeah. And then in the afternoon, the sun came out. We walked out into the flea market to get lunch, mm-hmm. and everyone was back out there having a good time as if nothing had happened. Yeah. So, you know,
that's Dayton.
Yeah.
Weather seems to have very little impact.
We adapt. In the flea market, in our tour on Friday, you had your eye on something you were coveting.
Oh, yes, yes.
And I asked you if maybe you would, we asked how much it was, and it was expensive.
Yeah.
And I asked if you thought you might get it, and you were...
I couldn't buy it that day. I won't spend that kind of money the day I see something. I need at least a day to work on it before I make that decision.
Let's see if Kay knows what this is. Go ahead and pick it up.
I guess there's no secret now that I actually did end up with it. Okay.
Last year we brought out a wolfhong and asked if you knew what that was, and you knew what
and
that
you
was.
Did.
That one I can nail. This one, I think I just lost the game of Stump the Band.
We're here on Antiques Roadshow.
Yes.
Looks like a toilet flushing handle, doesn't it? In fact, the action is a bit like one too, but the inside kind of gives it away.
Yeah, sort of a side swiper kind of a thing.
Yeah,
she nailed it.
It is a telegraph key. Yeah.
You get to keep your technician license.
And oh, gee, thanks.
Similar to
us. No, I never had a technician license. I went from novice to general because back in the early 80s when I was taking my exams, you'd go in with a novice license, and these exams were given at the FCC office in those days where a bureaucratic person would glare at you and hand you examination papers. And if you passed the 13-word-a-minute code test...
Straight to general.
The tech general test was all one examination. It was this great big indigestible thing. And if you passed the code test, then you went straight to general. If you did not pass the code test, then you were issued a technician license. You had to go back and pass the code at some other point. But by some absolute miracle, I managed to pass all of the above and went from novice to general. So my first, my first contacts, I never went on the air as a novice because I was only a novice for a week. And I went down.
Oh, you did good.
Well, in those days, it took a long time. In 1982, 83, it took a good 6 weeks for your novice license to arrive in the mail. It wasn't like today where 5 days after you pass the exam, you got your license grant, and you can go on the air. In those days, it took like 6 weeks, so I spent that time studying the book and practicing the code and got lucky and upgraded straight away.
Jeff went from zero to extra in one session. No, you waited about 2 weeks.
I ran out of time. I got too advanced that night, and just spent so much time waiting in lines to have papers graded that the session ran out, and so... At a ham fest a couple weeks later, I took the last one.
Oh, wow. Mm-hmm. The advanced class test, I remember as being the most difficult of the exams.
Yeah.
There was a lot of math, and I'm math challenged. And I remember driving to the FCC field office in north of Philadelphia, and I'm driving down the Pennsylvania Turnpike reciting the 14 formulas. And anybody who'd heard me would have thought, that woman's completely crazy. Give her a lot of space on the road. But I managed to
and
get
so
up
there.
So
what's different about that now?
Not much, but I'm just better at covering it up now.
Oh, no.
Just saying, the ARRL is never going to be on Ham Radio Now again.
Oh, dear.
I went through a similar deal. It was back in the actually 60s, but down at the Chicago FCC field office. And in the 60s, the technician license was a purgatory because we didn't have repeaters. We just barely had a few repeaters. There was a little AM activity. There was actually a cadre of hams, very high-tech hams. Sounds like we're having a percussion concert back there.
They're rolling a square barrel across the floor. I can see them.
Jeez. We didn't have the repeater infrastructure that we do and a few folks on AM, but there were a few folks that did really serious long-distance work on 2 meters and 70 centimeters with 100-foot towers and kilowatts and sideband and stuff like that. And they could do that with a technician license. But for most hams, not making the 13 words a minute was... And you know how that happened is that in those days, a novice could talk on 2-meter phone.
Yes, I remember being told that was possible at one time.
And you got your novice license, and you frittered your 1-year non-renewable license away talking on 2 meters and never upped your code speed by operating HF on Morse code. And so you could take the written test at that point and get your technician, but not your general. And then you were condemned to talk on 6 meter AM, which was fun once in a while. But so I skipped that step too. We were talking about Jeff's cool little acquisition here. This is rare, I understand, from you and the guy that we were talking to out in the flea market.
So what's the history on that?
Well, it's a it's from the Foot Pearson Company that began life in 1896 over in New Jersey and then later on moved into New York. They actually moved on to Fulton Street, just two blocks from where Viberplex once was. And the exact dates concerning this are a little bit sketchy. The first advertisement that I've ever seen this in was dated 1901. There was another sideswiper at the time from Jesse Bunnell. It was the Model W, double speed key is what they called it. This was called the Century Key. It was the common belief is that Bunnell's key came out in 1888, but apparently a historian in Troy, New York, his name is John Casale, I think, or
we'll take your word for it.
So he has some compelling evidence that this predates the Bunnell key, and I don't know what that evidence is because I haven't spoken to him about it. But I certainly would like to know. This one is missing a part. It's missing the back cover, and there was an optional base that came along later. And the base actually bears a patent number earlier than the key itself. The patent for this key was issued in 1908, but we know that things in those days, the patent could be pending for years. And I thought it was strange that the base had an earlier patent number than this particular key bears itself.
So you're still going to be in acquisition mode until you get all the rest of the pieces.
It probably won't be possible to find the back cover without the rest of the key.
Our phenomenal audience is undoubtedly someone's got one now.
The Foot Pearson pump handled 20th century key. If you have a back cover, I would love to hear from you.
Yep.
Okay,
now, what's
so
the
that's
point?
The deal.
What's the point of this key? Why is this key?
The deal is, it's not a sideswiper in Bunnell sense, in the traditional sense, where you could operate horizontally both directions. It only operates one direction, and as it would sit, and it probably won't demonstrate very well on camera here, but the lever pushes in one direction to make contact. The problem was the up and down motion was very difficult on some of the stuff in the carpal tunnel. They had a lot of names for the malady in the day. They called it, the common term was glass arm, but professionals called it telegrapher's paralysis.
And today we call it...
we call it repetitive motion disease, which covers a range of stuff because what it was called in the 90s was carpal tunnel syndrome.
That was the name I was thinking of.
Yeah, and that became an unpopular name. I'm not sure why. Now it's called repetitive motion disease.
Well, the more syllables you can get in, the more...
It's probably some insurance reason.
That's what I was thinking.
I don't think carpal tunnel syndrome became politically incorrect, but it suffered the fate of those things that do. So, carpal tunnel syndrome. That was the idea. After working with this for just maybe 15 minutes, though, I can feel a lot more fatigue in my arm than with the Bunnell key, which, of course, operates side by side. This requires the same number of motions as a vertical straight key, the traditional straight key. The Model W double speed key from Bunnell was half as many motions because each direction, you know, you would get an element out.
So a good
effective
idea, but nah.
Yeah.
And that's probably why it never really went anywhere. And the reason the Bunnell key never went anywhere, it went a little ways, but...
Horace Martin invented the bug just 4 years later.
Yeah. And that's the key the telegraphers decided they wanted to do.
Still today.
Yeah.
Still today, yeah.
And then, you stayed up late last night. You came this morning. You came down to breakfast and said, "I'm sleepy."
It had a couple of problems. The action was very stiff, not even usable, not close to usable. And the fellas I got it from had fooled with it all day and worked it and loosened it up some. But it actually, the casing here that the shaft goes through was bent. And I just happened to have the tools required in my tool bag because I do way too many service calls working on hardware and was able to straighten it out. And then the spring adjusting screw was significantly bent to the point that it wouldn't work
but I was able to straighten that out too.
And you did all that because yesterday I said, let's show the key on the show.
Yeah, and I wanted it functional.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Smoke and Solder. Sorry, George.
Okay.
So, and then you heard late last night on a radio you bought.
When I was a kid, two things launched me into the electronics field, and one was a kit I built, a night kit that was a shortwave receiver, AM only, a Star Roamer receiver, and I was, I think, 11 when I built that kit, and over the years, I have no idea whatever became of that receiver, but since coming to Dayton the last 4 or 5 years, I've
where,
been...
Where people say folks come to a ham fest like this to visit their old equipment.
Yeah.
I do.
I've been looking for one, but I've been looking for one in what you would call extraordinary condition, at least physical condition. Didn't
extraordinarily
care about the
good or extraordinarily bad?
Good. I wanted good condition. And the functionality didn't matter. It's a very simple circuit, and I have schematic for it, so I'm not worried about that. I just wanted it to look good. And yesterday, I found one for $40. It was a fellow selling his brother's estate, I think, and I don't have his name, but I bought that. And I took it to my room last night to see if it worked and was delighted to find panel lights come on and more delighted to hear sound come from the speaker. And I found an AM station from Cincinnati, WLW, I think their call was, at 700 kilohertz. And while I was listening to it and working on this telegraph key, a commercial came on. And you know the speaker's name. He's from...
Tom Baudette.
Tom Baudette from Motel 6.
We'll leave the light on.
Hi, Tom Baudette.
Right. And he was talking about coming to Dayton, and I was only partially paying attention to the commercial until the last 10 seconds.
Now, he wasn't talking about coming to the Hamvention. This was a commercial. If you're coming to Dayton, stay at Motel 6. We'll leave the light on.
That
for
sort
you.
Of thing. And there was some comment about family, if you have family in the area. And his parting comment was, if you don't have family.
I guess you're just ... I'm Tom Baudet for Motel 6, and we'll leave the light on for you.
And that was the end of the commercial. And I thought, did I just hear that?
Okay, so Kay understands what you just said. For the no-code techs out there, the no-code everybody,
you
the no-code extras.
You can tell by context.
Yeah, it's S-O-L.
It was not the standards of learning test either.
Standards of learning, that's good.
Well,
that's
in many states, of course, they have examinations to make sure that these students in the public schools are making adequate progress. Yeah. And in some states, they are called the Standards of Learning Test, which was a name no doubt applied by somebody before they looked at what the abbreviation would be.
Well, that's a TLA we won't be using.
Yep.
Three-letter acronym.
No, too long to announce. Okay. That's what TLA means.
Okay, so well, look, I'm going to get out of here and let you guys chat.
Yeah, and we should be able to get around to some of the indoor stuff on the Hamfest and do a little tour on Sunday. Anyway.
Okay.
We'll give it a try.
All right.
But now we're going to talk to Kay Craigie, so we'll end our introduction to Friday and head on to the tour. And if you want to talk to Kay or listen to me talk to Kay, you can't talk to Kay. We don't take calls. Tune in to the next episode of Ham Radio Now. For now, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
Jeff Whittick, AC4ZO.
Sure, go ahead.
I'm Kay Craigie in 3KN.
Stick on ARRL President. Give us some class.
Okay, ARRL President.
Over
and out.
Out. So that interview is online.
Okay.
Let me see if I can get to the spot. There it is.
Episode 80.
Episode 80. So if you missed episode 80, we have a good conversation with Kay Craigie in episode 80. But I think that we got a more natural one. But she did a really good job. A lot of times you're talking to people from official organizations representing the organizations, and they feel constrained to
very sterile conversations.
Yeah. And she did have to toe some party lines, but she also, I think, gave us some real, here's how she feels about things. Mm-hmm. But in this little conversation, we had a good time. We talked about a couple of things that you acquired. And I asked you to bring them, so we'll just, we'll stick them in front of the camera again. Go reach behind you and see what you can.
Well, this is the lighter one of the two,
which didn't get on camera very well because I never was quite sure where the cameras were looking. Well, now we can see where the cameras are looking. So I'm going to switch your camera on here. That's the one you're looking at. And have you done any more with that?
No,
No, it's just been sitting. It had a bent shaft in here, and I straightened that out so it'd be operational. But that's
you haven't put it on the air.
No, it hasn't been on the air. Okay. And it doesn't need much to get on the air. Just the output wiring needs cleaning up with some fabric insulated wire.
Okay, so that is, and that what's the name of that again?
It's a Foot Simpson key. This one bears serial number 823.
There was a Pearson there, wasn't there? Pearson. Foot Pearson.
Foot yeah. Pearson key.
Yeah, which whoops. I recognize because it's part of my name, although I spelled it wrong. Okay, and so the other deal.
The other one. Is one something I've been looking for years at the Hamfest.
Let's see if we can get that on this camera here at all.
Okay.
Not very well.
Okay, no.
We don't have a cameraman.
It's much too big. Let's go back to there. That's good. It's an old night kit shortwave receiver. It covers from long wave up through HF and ends at 30 megahertz. And I built one when I was but a child from a kid. It was a Christmas present one year. And I don't know whatever happened to it, but it was around the time I got married that it disappeared. And that's when I was 18. And I have been looking for one since, but I wanted one that was in pretty doggone good shape. And, you know, finding them with melted S meters and missing knobs and all kinds of other problems is common, but one in really good shape is not. This one needs a headphone jack, but I have a jack. It's just a simple closed circuit jack.
So have you done any more with it since?
Nope. The night I bought it.
Just the way of things, isn't it?
Yeah. The night I bought it, I listened to it in the hotel room on a broadcast station from Cincinnati.
You see, you got to understand something. We did not just watch the entire interview with Kay Craigie.
Because did I talk about this?
Yes, you did.
Oh.
And the audience has already seen you talk about that and me play that broadcast.
Wow. Let's move on.
This is the magic of television. I'm leaving this in because it shows, because you got to get going. So we didn't watch the whole interview.
Okay.
All right. So you were there.
Came with me today.
I guess the point being that you buy these things and you do nothing with them.
Yeah, I haven't retired yet from work.
They keep you busy. Yeah, you're in acquisition mode.
I will, I'll get the hankering to do something with them. And when I do, I'll have it to tinker with.
All right. You got a favorite, let me exhibit my ignorance of even the terminology, even though I've been to a few NASCAR races. Do you have a favorite race car driver?
Oh, I do, he's a polarizing driver. People really detest the
don't do anything polarizing here on Ham Radio Now.
Yes.
As Leo Laporte says, we are tame journalists.
Okay, I'm a Jimmy Johnson fan and a Hendrix fan and have been for many years since before they were even very popular.
Yeah, little felt rocks have been thrown at computer monitors all over America.
Rocks, yeah. Yeah, and I'm sorry, Gibbs fans, Roush fans. I'm sorry, I'm a Hendrix fan.
So you can take a scanner. I was going to ask you to bring the scanner, but I forgot.
Oh, yeah, it's in the bag, ready to go.
Okay.
The ScanCat 230 from Uniden.
I was listening to a conversation on a local repeater where some folks were talking about listening to scanning at NASCAR tracks.
Yeah.
You're going to Lowe's. Is this still called Lowe's Motor Speedway?
No, it's Charlotte Motor Speedway now.
Lost their sponsorship. Mm-hmm. So the ham I was listening to and eventually broke in and talked on was talking about lots of Intermod and stuff. Because there are hundreds of transmitters going on at these events.
Yeah. 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 But Intermod has not been a problem for me. I mean, you don't take your fashionable 2-foot duck. You put essentially a dummy load on there, a very small antenna, because while there's a lot of transmitters, you know, you're close to all of them. And so it doesn't require very much antenna. Never had a problem with Intermod. I listened to lots of things at the track besides just the drivers and crews.
Yeah, and you're not listening to 100-watt paging systems. These guys are only running a few watts.
Yep.
As you said, I think you can barely hear the driver if he's on the other side of the track.
Well, if you're out on the far side of the parking lot, which is a mile away, you can't.
Okay, from the parking lot.
You can't hear. Yeah. In the stands, you can hear all over the track and the operations. Yeah.
Yeah. And besides the drivers, I mean, all the drivers have radio equipment.
Right.
And besides the drivers and the crews are talking to the crews, that's interesting listening to them talk to the crews.
Yeah, mostly what you hear while the race is going on is a guy up on the roof that's telling the driver where the cars are around him, you know, to his right, to his left, you know, there's one coming up on you and so forth. He's called a spotter, and he's a very necessary part of the team, but that's mostly who you hear. And it's to people that aren't interested in communications, it'd be very, very boring.
But when there's an incident of some kind.
then you want a scanner that can quickly switch to the driver of the car that's involved. You want to hear that.
Yeah.
That's when you hear some excitement.
Yep. Yeah.
But there's a lot of other things to listen to it to track. You know, all the logistical people, the parking people, the people that make delivery to the hundreds of food vendors there. It's interesting just to listen to the rich club, you know, where the rich people go and sit. There's a lot of radio operations.
You mean like us,
people
like us, people that have successful Kickstarters and can afford these skyboxes.
I have to sit out in the mud and the blood and the beer with the cheap seats.
Yeah. Well, I'm no race fan, but I've been three times, and I concentrated on the scanning.
It was this race a year ago today. You went with me with.
Yep. And I think I could have just about as much fun sitting outside still doing the scanning, because you can still hear everything if you're not too far away.
Yeah. Yeah.
And maybe watch the race on TV so I got an idea what's going on.
Yeah, you actually get better replays. Well, at most tracks you would. At this track, you know, it does have the world's largest HD screen, 16,000 square feet.
Yeah, it is huge.
Yeah, 200 by 80.
And you end up watching the screen more than you do the race.
It's really big.
Yep. So have a good time.
Okay. Thanks so much.
We're going to push you out the door. We will wrap up this episode of Ham Radio Now. Okay. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
I'm Jeff, AC4ZO.
Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time. Over.
And out.